the school's role in vaccines development and testing is very wide. So it starts from really basic science, coming up with potential vaccine candidates and looking at the immunology, right the way through to doing large-scale field trial and then looking at the policy implications and the mathematical modelling. So the school's interest in vaccines goes right across the board. My main research area is on the spread of infectious diseases. So what we look at is how diseases spread through communities and then how best to control them. And one of the best ways we have for controlling infectious diseases is vaccines. There are groups that are hesitant about vaccination, and a few, and it's really quite rare, who refuse vaccination. Mostly, failure to vaccinate individuals isn't about people refusing it or being hesitant. It's mostly just difficulties in reaching communities and us failing to reach out and get and make it easy for people to be vaccinated.
I'm a rabbi and a school principal, and I'm chairman of the Haredi Health Forum. We work close together with the health authorities, the GPs, and health professionals in the hospitals to improve services to the Haredi community. We deal with many issues. One of the ones which have been most challenging is the issue of immunizations. There are some challenges, you know, to do with large families. An average size family is 7. General practice is not having the correct facilities. When I mean correct facilities, when a mother comes with a number of children, there's no place where to put a baggy. It is practical reasons, and they can be overcome. In terms of programs to address immunisation, Hackney GP Confederation has come up with a scheme where they're going to spend £220,000 for 2 years to address those issues. And they're even thinking about mobile units going to visit parents at home. There's a very serious commitment, both from the authorities and both from the community, and I'm confident that we will get there.
It's without a shadow of a doubt that vaccines are one of the most important public health tools we've got. On the introduction of any vaccine, there's considerable uncertainty. We usually have a fairly good idea about its safety profile, and we have a fairly good idea about its effectiveness at protecting individuals. What we don't know is how that will then pan out at a population level, because if we protect some individuals, then it has a knock-on effect on others, because if by protecting some individuals, you also prevent them infecting other individuals. So we use mathematical models. That's sort of the work that I do. We use mathematical models to try and predict it, to try and predict the effect that it will have on populations and how this pans out over time. Me and my team were involved with the successful Ebola trial, and we were involved in both the design and the analysis of that trial. There was a vaccine trial, phase 3 vaccine trials, which are these kind of pivotal vaccines. This is to prove whether the vaccine actually works. And a number of these were tried with the Ebola crisis, and I was involved with one of these trials, in fact two of the trials, but one of them where we designed it specifically, and that's the one, the only one of the sort of 4 or 5 trials that was successful. So we now have an Ebola vaccine. We've now introduced flu vaccination in children. Now that's a big change. We used to vaccinate the elderly and at-risk groups. I led all the work for the analysis of all of that. But we've done a lot of work, my team and myself, in conjunction particularly with PHE on HPV and HPV vaccination. We introduced the vaccine in schoolgirls in 2008. Heterosexual men are protected via their sexual partners who are protected. So by protecting the females, then you also protect the males. There is another group, of course, that are not protected, and that's gay men. A couple of years ago, we introduced vaccination for gay men. It may be that some gay men are not being effectively vaccinated. We have to look into that and see how well coverage is being achieved. An alternative way to protect gay men is to protect everybody by vaccinating boys. We would be doubling the cost of the program by doing that. And, you know, are the benefits worth it, given that we are already trying to reach out and vaccinate gay men? It's a balance. Challenges in terms of the big diseases that we don't have a vaccine for. I think some of these outbreak-prone diseases, which are often rare, evaluating those, I think that's a major challenge. I think looking at the use of vaccines in emergency situations, like in war and earthquake and those sorts of things, I think we could probably do a lot more protecting what are frankly some of the most vulnerable people in the world. There'll always be an ongoing challenge in order to convince people to keep vaccinating, particularly against diseases that are now very rare because we've been vaccinating. That becomes a challenge for the public health system, because if you stop vaccinating, the disease will come back. Convincing people about the value of vaccines will always be a challenge.